means a spin orbit using the spin orbit interaction in heavy materials. The spin orbit is found in heavy metal, for example, to prepare, to fabricate, to create the spin currents from charge currents or charge currents detect the spin currents. And so, in fact, this is more or less how the well-known spin orbit effects in 3D materials. It's called a spinor effect, probably used in some applications. But today, the most promising effects are supposed to be in the two-dimensional system, computation of spin orbit, symmetry breaking, topological effects on dance in two dimensions. And so, for example, what can be done with what is called a Hashmi interface, the property of two-dimensional gas at Hashmi interface, or also two-dimensional electron gas at the surface of the new material for topological insulators. Sometimes it's topological insulator as far as the new state of matter.
Also, to interesting spin orbit effect in two dimensions as the interface between oxide, between insulating oxides. In graphene, if some additional spin orbit interaction are added to graphene, and also there are interesting two-dimensional effects at the interface between EV metal, large spin orbit grouping, and thin films for the production, for example, of skirmions. But this is not, will be in the my scope today, will be maybe next year we give only a lecture on skirmions. So spinor effect in a metal like platinum with large spin orbit coupling, in any metal, but mainly when the spin orbit coupling is large, the effect is significant. You have a deflection due to the spin orbit, deflection of the spin up electron on the in this direction, spin down the electron on the other, and the final result is that there will be accumulation of this spin direction on this side of the track, and accumulation and depletion, of course, of the opposite spin direction for charge neutrality. And on the other side, there will be accumulation of spin down and depletion of spin up. Okay, there is no accumulation of charge in the normal Hall effect. There is accumulation of charge on one side, and so there is a voltage. Here, there is no accumulation of charge up and down, no contribution to the voltage. But anyhow, this effect can be detected, and there are several mechanisms. Last lesson, I described one of the mechanisms of this deflection of electron, which is the spinol, the skew scattering, say, by an impurity. Scattering by an impurity, if you scatter electron, spin up, spin down, by this impurity. In fact, the scattering can be described by this sort of deflection and orbiting of the electron clockwise or anti-clockwise as the electron. If there was no spin orbit coupling, the choice will be being scattered like that on the other direction. But if you introduce this spin orbit interaction, that means that the scattering potential is not the same for clockwise and anti-clockwise orbit, L. And so this really for the Z spin direction, the electron will be more scattered as in this direction, with orbiting clockwise and scattering to the left. And the opposite, the effect will be opposite for the opposite spin direction. And this effect is one of the mechanisms of the spinor effect. You understand that this is one of the ways you can deflect electron on the left, to the left or to the right. And this is what is called an extrinsic contribution to the spinor effect. It's a scattering effect induced by impurity with large spin orbit coupling like bismuth or platinum. And there is also another mechanism called the sigem scattering that I will not describe. And anyhow, even if there is, you don't add impurity with large spin-orbi coupling, if the spin-orbi coupling in the band itself, in the band metal itself, is large, you have also an entry that a little more complex to describe, but that contribute to the spin-all effect. The spin-all effect can be detected, for example, optically by Kerr imaging of the spin accumulation. Using a Kerr microscope, you can see the accumulation of the opposite spin direction, red and blue, on the opposite side of the channel of this conductor. And this is the first recent observation of the spin-all effect. There are also possibility of electrical detection of these accumulations. I will come back also on experiments allowing to measure, to detect and measure the spin-all effect electrically. Generally, this situation is not the most useful in experiments. Can be understood easily this way, but in most experiments that are developed today, it's better to be in this situation, that is a thin film, and looking at the deflection of this spin direction. This spin direction will be deflected to the upward, and this one downward. And the symmetry is the same. It's a sort of that a current going along X with will be deflected along Z with spin along Y. Yeah? This is always a triangle of the three directions. And so there will be accumulation on the top of this spin direction, accumulation and depletion of the red spin direction, and the opposite on the other interface or surface of the film. And this is more convenient because then you can, if it can be used, for example, if you put a magnetic material on the top, in fact, this spin accumulation here will diffuse. So this spin direction, spin accumulation means accumulation of the blue spin direction that we diffuse on upward into this magnetic material, while the depletion of the red spin direction will attract red spin from the top, from the material to the bottom layer, and this is what is called an injection of a pure spin current. Will be and this injection of a pure spin current in a magnetic material by using the spin transfer torque can be harnessed to switch, for example, the magnetization of this layer or to put into motion the domain walls or skirmions. This is a very good way to manipulate using the spin-all effect. It's very convenient and already used in what is called spin-orbit torque rams to go to device. There is also the spin-all effect as an inverse effect, inverse spin-all effect, in the same way, the opposite of this is injection, and the opposite is injection from a ferromagnetic material. You can do, for example, a ferromagnetic resonance to create a spin accumulation in the ferromagnetic material and then inject the spin currents, and that inject this spin direction, extract this spin direction, and then the effect, the deflection of this injected currents in the same way as this deflection, create a charge current. So the spin-all effect is the creation of spin current, a vertical spin current from an horizontal charge current, and the inverse spin-all effect is the creation of a charge current from the injection of a vertical spin current. So there is two examples of conversions. This conversion, of course, spintronic is based on the creation of spin currents from charge currents, because with the electrical plug you have only charge currents, and on the contrary, to detect a spin currents and to convert it in something we can measure with a voltmeter, this is the opposite conversion, and this can be done by this effect. So mathematically, the spin-off effect can be described by this non-diagonal element in the resistivity tensor with opposite sign for the spin-up and spin-down in the z directions. So this, and you can also write equal is omitted here, okay, is forgot it, and you can also describe in the conductivity sensor by this non-diagonal conductivity term with this classical relation between x sigma xy and rho xy. And what one calls the spin-off angle is the ratio between the non-diagonal and the diagonal element. And so if one writes, for example, what is the currents created by this conductivity tensor, one sees that the current of spin-up is sigma xy ex, sigma xy multiplies the x component of the current along y of spin along z is given by this expression. Electric field along x multiplied by this element, this is the result of this expression. And yes, simply the whole angle. The whole angle is defined at this ratio is the whole angle multiplied by gx. So the current of spin up along z created in the y direction is the charge current multiplied by phi h. And this is the same thing for the opposite spin direction, so that the spin currents is twice phi h gx. So what are these all angles? This all angle can be large in materials with large spin-orbit coupling, that is 5D elements, ferrium, platinum, not, okay, they are not always very, very large, 5% here. For tungsten, one or for pure materials, a very large effect can be obtained with tungsten, up to 30%. Or also by adding in material like copper, bismuth impurity, 12%, of recently in our with recent work that appears now in PRL, is with tantalum impurity in gold, 50%, 0.5. So now the spin-off angle can be relatively large. In fact, the whole angle is the yield of the conversion of charge current density, because in this expression, this was the charge current density on the field. It's not, there is no geometrical factor. This is a charge density, the spin or charge current density. This phi h is a conversion for the density of charge current density into spin current density, or the opposite for the inverse spin-off effect. But in this sort of experiments, for example, in fact, what you, if you look not at the ratio between the charge current density and the spin current density, if you want to have the, for example, the ratio between the spin currents and the charge current, you have to multiply by the section. And in fact, in this sort of experiment, if this section is larger, you have, with respect to this cross section here, you can increase and have a spin current much larger than the spin, the charge current, if this section is much larger than the section of the horizontal conductor. So the spin current is very convenient, because by geometrical effect, you can really increase the conversion factor. Maybe a little more complex, but as I say, in a layer, you see the layer relatively this is the top and the bottom of the layer. You have a deflection of this mineration to the top, but of course accumulation here of this mineration. That means if I call delta mu, I introduce what is the spin accumulation, delta mu yesterday. So there is an increase. If you plot the spin accumulation delta mu as a function of z, you can see the profile of the spin accumulation, so the air accumulation of the red spin that progressively repels the current. The phi h, rho, the maximum current is only at the center and progressively stop, and because of course the current cannot escape this way. And the same thing, this spin current is maximum in this range and stops at the edge, of course, it cannot go further. If there is an additional material, in fact, this spin current can go through, and the maximum current that can be go through is simply phi h multiplied by the charge current. Yeah. Okay. All these problems, it was simply all these problems can be of distribution of the spin currents and spin accumulation inside this structure can be described by the equation, drift diffusion equation that I have described yesterday. Okay, so one of the main applications of these equations that I have described yesterday are to describe how evolve as a function of the position, the spin current and spin accumulation in this sort of structure. Okay, so it was simply to describe more precisely the... Okay, so I skip this. One type of experiments that can be developed to measure the spin hole angle, the good quantity is the spin hole angle, is this sort of experiments with this more or less on a structure of lateral spin valve. So this is in a lateral spin valve, one inject from a ferromagnetic conductor permalloy here, a spin current here, one inject this current this way. There is a spin, first I suppose there is no copper head. I want to measure, for example, the spin hole effect of copper iridium. But suppose now that this copper iridium does not exist, we have a classical spin valve, so there is we have a classical spin valve, in this classical spin valve, we have in the structure like we had yesterday, so injecting a spin here or here create a spin accumulation decreasing exponentially to the right, and by measuring the voltage between a ferromagnetic contact and a non-magnetic contact, this voltage here between here and here, you can measure the spin accumulation. And you can see by sweeping the field to reverse this magnetization respect to this one, or the contrary, you have the non-local voltage, which is a measure of the spin accumulation here. There is a spin current going, there is a spin up going this way, spin down this way. Related to the spin accumulation profile, you have a spin current on this part of the structure with a spin accumulation. And now, looking at the problem now with the copper iridium, you want to measure the spin hole effect of the copper iridium. That means that you have a spin accumulation here, and so this spin accumulation injects vertically. In fact, we will measure this way the inverse spin hole effect. You inject from the spin accumulation a spin current into the copper iridium, and this injection of these two spin directions, it means that this spin will be injected, this spin will be extracted, give rise by the inverse spin hole effect, a charge current in this field measured by some voltage. Okay, and so, and the experiment, first, because a part of the spin current is absorbed by copper iridium, yeah? The voltage that you measure between these two decrease. You are going from blue to red, huh? So there is the fact that a part of the spin accumulation has been absorbed by the copper iridium, by the heavy material. Iridium is a heavy metal. This is an alloy of copper with iridium. Spinel effect is due to the skew scattering by iridium. And then, by in addition, if you to obtain a contribution, you need having spins in this direction. So if you switch the magnetization, the maximum effect will be when by polarizing the magnetization of the spin in this direction here. And so you see, you can see, depending on the direction, you will be positive or negative effect. You can see the curve you can obtain by sweeping the field. And when the field is oriented in the right direction, that is this direction here, to obtain an injection like that, you obtain a signal reverse when you reverse the field. And this corresponds to the orientation of the magnetization in this direction, so that the injection is spin in this direction, and if you apply the rule of the deflection, this spin direction is deflected in this direction, and you can measure a voltage between these two voltage contacts here. Okay. So, in fact, if you want to understand clearly, you have always having in mind a triad X, Y, Z to see what are the right direction. So finally, if you polarize the permalloy in this direction, the injection is of this spin direction, the extraction of this spin direction, and this you obtain a current or a voltage in this direction of the copper. So, and so you can compare the results. This is for copper bismuth, actually. This one is for copper iridium, and this one is for copper alone. Copper alone, there is practically a negligible spinel effect. Copper platinum and copper iridium gives more or less the same curves, the blue and green. And copper bismuth give an opposite effect compared to copper iridium and copper and platinum, which is this one. And for example, one can check, for example, that copper iridium is something due to the skew scattering to bare impurity. If it is due to skew scattering by this 6% of impurity, it will be proportional to the concentration of impurity that you can see here. The spinel, the Rho xy is proportional to Rho xx, to the concentration of impurity here. And so you have this typical effect of a spinel effect induced by impurity, by the skew scattering, by this EV iridium impurity. Okay. So you can see this is one of the ways. So these techniques are well master today to measure this is a measurement of the inverse spinel effect. You inject a spin current and you detect a charge current, and you have also the opposite effect with the same system. You can pass a charge current here. Then we will inject a spin current into the copper here, and this spin current will create a spin accumulation that can be detected here, and this is the inverse. The experiments can be done also in this way and give the same results. Yeah. Okay. This is a spinel effect. There is another way, even simpler, to measure the spinel effect. Putting, for example, the platinum. You want to measure the spinel effect of platinum. You put a layer of platinum here on a ferromagnetic material, cobalt, iron, boron, and you are exciting the ferromagnetic resonance. When you excite the ferromagnetic resonance, that means that you excite these precessions. Exciting this precession means putting the system in a non-equilibrium regime. And so you mean that in this regime, because the system is not aligned along the direction of the field, but it's precessing, you are an out of equilibrium reduction of the magnetization of the spin along the direction, the main direction. And so this is equivalent to create a spin accumulation in the ferromagnetic material. Other way of creating spin accumulation is doing ferromagnetic resonance. So then you create a spin accumulation along this direction, and so you inject a spin current with a polarization direct in this direction here, along the red arrow, and the inverse spinal effect will induce a spin current, a charge current into the platinum that you can detect by this voltage. The voltage needed to balance the charge currents and to create zero current. So the voltage is easy measurements. And so this can be done with several materials. This is a very easy way. If you put the system, you don't need the lithography to do that. You put simply a small piece like that in the cavity for the FMR, for the ferromagnetic resonance. What you see, for example, that black is without platinum, and you see that when you are the first thing that you can see adding platinum, because when you send a spin current what is absorbed by the platinum, that means that this gives an additional damping to the resonance. And so, and you know that when you're doing a resonance, the width of the resonance is proportional to the damping. So adding another mechanism of damping with platinum through the spinal effect enlarge the resonance. You are going from the black to the red, and here too you are going from, and this is the resonance line, as a function of the field, and so from the broadening you can know what is, from the increase of the damping that you can easily derive, you know what is the spin current that is injected from the ferromagnetic metal into the platinum. And so you know what is the spin current that is injected, and if you measure the charge current here, you will know what is the magnitude of the spinal effect. Then when you measure this voltage here, the voltage needed to compensate, to balance the charge currents induced by spinal effect, you see this signal just at the resonance, you see that there is an injection, and so you have a voltage just at the position of the resonance. Okay, I suppose my pointer is not working as well as before. Okay, but you can see now, so maybe I have another one. Okay, it can be all seen. And so you can see also by reversing the direction of the field of the resonance here, you reverse the signal. So this is typical results of measurement of the, as you know, the charge current from these experiments, you can derive what is the coefficient, what is the spinal angle of platinum or tantalum. Okay, so this conversion between spin current and charge currents are all they used in some device that are called SO-Theram. In a SO-Theram like this one, this is like a ram, that is two magnetic layers separated by a tunneling barrier of MgO. And generally in the ram of today, in the SO-Therams, you send a vertical current to reverse the free layer, but or to reverse this free layer here. And what can be done in the SO-Theram, either on sending a current across the barrier with energy consuming and heating the sample, you can also simply load a charge current into the tantalum. The spinal effect inject a spin current vertically in this layer, and in some condition can reverse the magnetization of this layer. This is what is called SOTERAM, an experimental example in this sort of systems. As a function of the current in the tantalum here, which is a metal with large Spinel effect, at some threshold value, you switch the magnetization, and so you increase the tunnel resistance because you are introducing an anti-parallel configuration. And back, reversing the current, you can come back to the initial parallel configuration of these two layers. Yeah. Okay. So this is principle of the SOTERAM, who have an advantage of very, very short switching time, very short switching time, smaller than 1/10 of a nanosecond. Okay, so now after this overview of the spinel effect, which is obtained in three-dimensional material, is layer with some thickness, I can proceed to what can be done in two dimensions by using the spin-orbit effect in two dimensions at a hash bar or a topological insulator interface. We'll see if I have a pointer with a... What will be the... Comparison. Yeah, this one is better. Okay. Okay, so we use this one. Okay. So, but, and this one still to, okay, maybe I can, okay, I have two hands, so I can. Okay. And the microphone is the color. Okay. Okay, so I continue. So what is the characteristic of a hash bar two-dimensional electron gas? Suppose an interface between a material with large spin-orbit coupling, like bismuth and silver. There is an interface in between metals. There is, in general, surface state, interface states, two-dimensional interface states. And in the situation of hash bar interfaces, there is also, if there is a spin-orbit coupling, the spin-orbit coupling is even enhanced by the breaking of the symmetry by the existence of an electric field. This is what is called the hash bar effect. And there is on these electrons, these two-dimensional electrons, what is called the hash bar interaction. The hash bar interaction is acting on the spin, but you see it introduces a splitting of the energy of the spin up and spin down, or two spin direction, but you can see that it depends also on the okay. In fact, the splitting of the spin will be opposite for opposite direction of the wave vector, as you can see on this graph here. That means if you start with a dispersion curve, like a quadratic curve, energy as a function of k, adding the hash bar interaction on this side for k positive, you have the energy of the red spins above the energy of the blue spins, and the opposite on the other side. And so finally, in three dimensions, they give you this. You have two dispersion curve, this dispersion surface, and if you suppose you cut at some energy, the Fermi energy, you will have two contours in two dimensions. There is no Fermi surface, but a Fermi contour. Hein. You have these two Fermi contours, and the property of these Fermi contours is that you have a locking between the spin and the momentum degree of Erdős. If k is along y, the spin of this state is along x. And if we are along x, the spin is along y, etc. And so, and you have, in fact, two Fermi contours with opposite chirality. And this property is called locking between spin and momentum in these hash bar systems. And in fact, it's even simpler for topological insulator. In topological insulators, the dispersion surfaces like that are sort of cones, cones with a unique chirality. So if you cut the at a given energy, you have some contour with this locking, with this spin momentum, and not here you have some compensation between the two. Here is even simpler. You have simply one Fermi contour. You have raised the spin degeneracy, and you have this locking between spin and momentum. Spin, spin along k along y, spin along x, etc., etc. So, experimental example. This is this contour can be explored by the spectroscopic technique, which is ARPES, generally by in synchrotron radiation. Example of hash bar dispersion curves, and also example of the cones for this topological insulator here. You can see the, and of course, on the there is a spin polarized ARPES allows to determine this chirality of the locking here. Can be clockwise or anti-clockwise. What can be done? Interesting effects that I will describe now is what is called the Edelstein effect, inverse Edelstein effect. It's really is more or less like spin-Hall effect and inverse spin-Hall effect, but in two dimensions. So suppose with a simple system of topological insulator with a single contour, suppose you are flowing a charge current in this direction, yeah? That means flowing a current means that the current is shifting because the charge is negative, shifting the Fermi contour in the opposite direction. So a charge current can be characterized by some shift of the Fermi contour in the direction opposite to the current, to the charge current. And so that means that flowing a current means adding an additional population on this side of the initial Fermi contour was in the dotted line here. You add some new states, you populate new states here, and you depopulate these states here. You're going from the dotted line to the solid line. So that means, but due to the locking, that means that flowing currents, you introduce only, you add additional state with this spin direction, and you empty, you are emptying states with the opposite spin direction. That means you are creating a spin polarization in this direction. Okay. So the Edelstein effect, a charge current Gx introduce a non-zero spin density xy, sigma y. So Edelstein effect, you create a spin density, and the opposite is, suppose you inject a spin current, you will inject this spin direction and extract this spin direction. So so you will inject spins on this side, starting from the equilibrium dotted line here. You inject spin on this side, you extract spin on this side, and so finally, yes, this corresponds to creating a charge current in this direction. And so this is injection of spin current induces a charge current Gx. Okay, and in fact, mathematically, okay, the spin current that you are injecting is a three-dimensional spin current, amps, amperes per meter square, for example, and the charge current in two dimension is amp per meter, two-dimensional, and so what is called the Edelstein lane is the ratio between these two, which is of course a length, to transform a amps per meter square into amps per meter. And for example, the theory gives that it is simply proportional to the Fermi velocity and tau. And with hash bar interface, it's a little more complex. because these are two contours with some compensation between the two, but not complete compensation because one is smaller than the other, and the result is more or less the same, except that this length is proportional to the alpha Rajba coefficient here. But this works exactly in the same way. That is, a charge currents induce a non-zero spin density, and the injection of a spin current, and that can be, of course, this non-zero spin density can be used to inject a spin current in another layer, like the spin Hall effect. It will be used easily, and the inverse is injecting a spin current create a charge current. This is two examples of conversion between charge current and spin currents. That is the main mechanism needed in any spintronic experiment. So there is also another effect that I want simply to mention. In addition, when there is a charge current in the two-dimensional electron gas, topological insulator or Rajba, there is creating of a transverse spin density like that, x, y, but also there is a sort of spin Hall effect that is now it can create also a spin current, not a spin density, a spin current with the spin along z, like the spin Hall effect. This effect is not well known and much more difficult to derive. Okay, so experiments. So the experiments we present will be experiments of spin pumping from a ferromagnetic material into Rajba interfaces or the interface, the surface of topological insulator. So what I say for the topological insulator is for the two-dimensional topological insulator. I have not the time to describe what is it. It's a material which is insulating, but there is only at the surface two metallic electrons, two-dimensional metallic electrons, and what I have described is for this two-dimensional metallic electron. I forgot to introduce the topological insulator before. So in both cases, these systems are two-dimensional systems, so either the two-dimensional electron gas as the interface, or Rajba interface, or the two-dimensional electron gas at the surface of a topological insulator or the interface of topological insulator with another material. So we are, I am speaking about two types of two-dimensional effect characterized, two-dimensional electron gas, characterized in both cases by this locking between spin and momentum. In contrast to classical electrons, where you have 2 degrees of freedom, spin and momentum, these states are characterized by only a single degree of freedom because spin and momentum are always locked. Okay, this is the interest of this new, as one say, new state of matter for the topological insulator. And there are also new compounds called real metals with more or less the same property. So the experiments that we present are the following. So inject into, for example, Rajba, it would be bismuth-silver interface. Then it will be the interface between a topological insulator and silver too. So experiments I will describe briefly. This is a system spin pumping, doing the ferromagnetic resonance here and looking if there is a current flowing here. So detecting if there is a voltage. And so it works, it does not work if the injection is only in silver. Spin Hall effect of silver is small compared to this Edelstein effect. There is a small effect with bismuth because the spin Hall effect of bismuth is not negligible, but there is a large effect when there is the Rajba interface silver bismuth and you have this large signal. And the characteristic of the large signal is that by reversing the order, silver above bismuth or bismuth above silver, you reverse this effect. Yeah. So this is a clear signature. And what can be derived is this Edelstein lens, inverse Edelstein lens, that does not depend on the other parameter. It's a constant characteristic of this Rajma interface. And according to this result in Japan, does not depend practically on temperature. And so this is this lens is of the order of 0.2, 0.3 nanometer. So topological insulator, I will consider this topological insulator that can be, for example, characterized in this by ARPES. You can see the cone, yeah? So conical dispersion. And if you cut at the Fermi level, you have this contour, and spin resolver ARPES shows that the chirality is like that. The spins are locked in like that on this picture. And in fact, these experiments were from the synchrotron Soleil in Gif-sur-Yvette, close to Paris. So we worked then with these guys to exactly prepare. So it's for alpha thin, it's thin layers. This is for 25 layers of tin. We worked also, but adding on the alpha thin, silver and permalloy and iron to do spin pumping experiments and to look at the property of this interface state of alpha. This is cones with a free surface of the topological insulator, the cone with the chirality I have shown. And when coating with layer is destroys the cones, the hybridization with iron, and so we have been obliged to put a thin layer of silver between iron and the tin. This makes that there is only a small shift of the Dirac point. This is what is called a Dirac cones, and but we work on this sample, and the experiments are more or less like those I have shown for bismuth silver, that is, if there is directly spin pumping on silver, there is nothing, or so even directly iron on tin, there is nothing. But when there is a cone, when there is the tin protected by silver, then we obtain this signal now with a much 10 times larger spin division lens. Of course, topological insulator, there is a single contour and not contour with some compensation, is more efficient. And so this alpha thin is very efficient. This is at room temperature to convert a spin current into charge currents or to convert a charge current into spin current. So it can be checked that the chirality, the direction of the signal, the sign of this voltage, on the sign of this current, is agree with the chirality derived from spin resolver ARPES. What can be seen is can be used also to extract this relaxation time, but I skip this sort of thing. And I show another example of Rajma interfaces. That also is a new type of Rajma interface, is the interface between two insulating oxide, LAO, what is called LAO, STO, they are insulating. This is experimental results, this is for two, in fact, for only the LAO can be one or two or three or four units. And again, and the experiment will be done also by adding a gate to shift the Fermi level in the complex dispersion curves. And you see, according to the, on obtained very large effects, this is the charge current induced by the spin pumping here. And but then it can be also modulated depending on the gate voltage that fix where is the Fermi level on this band structure. So again, another system with a very large, Edelstein, inverse Edelstein length. So, okay. And I can show an example of the effect in the opposite relation, that is sending a current in the in a two dimension, in an insulating, in the surface state of an insulating topological insulator, yeah. So it induces some spin density that diffuse and give a spin current and change the damping by spin transfer torque of the ferromagnetic metal. And also what can be derived from these experiments is the conversion coefficient that is called Q in this experiment. In the concentration X, you can shift the Fermi level from above the Dirac point here of the cone or to below, and you can see that the evolution of the coefficient Q as a function of the position of the Fermi level with respect to the Dirac cone. So this result, in fact, I don't have the time to continue in this direction, but what it can be shown is that these conversions are much more efficient than the conversion by the three-dimensional spinor effect. Okay. And now Intel is beginning to develop devices based on topological insulator or Schaba interface. So that will be much more efficient than what can be done with the spinor effect, even if the spinor effect was more efficient than what has been obtained by classical spin transfer torque. Okay, so I can end with a few slides on, because these two-dimensional electron gas are interesting, but of course with a smaller mobility than graphene. So what would be attractive, which is very attractive, is if in graphene, a two-dimensional electron gas, the spin-out effects that have been explored for the Edelstein conversions could be also enhanced in some way, functional injection of graphene. And this is one of the interesting objectives that are followed by several groups. And this is more or less also what we are doing here with Laura and Anna. So graphene, this is graphene. And graphene, one knows from theoretical paper that the spin orbit coupling is very small, of course, because carbon is a light element with a very small spin orbit coupling, no relativistic effect, but it can be enhanced, for example, by depositing ad atoms. This theoretical paper, well known, shows that depositing some metallic atoms on graphene enhanced considerably. And there are already some experiments showing that. For example, these experiments of graphene deposited on gold have shown that, in fact, the Dirac cone of graphene, which is here, the Dirac cone of graphene, is split, has a Rashba splitting by the proximity induced by proximity on gold. In fact, you know the classical Dirac cone of graphene, and with this cone, there are two spin directions are present. The interaction of with a material with large spin orbit coupling transforms this cone into these double cones with some chirality induced in this contour, like for a Rashba interface, as you have seen and described by this expression. And so one of the ideas is to, by proximity effect, induce terms, and then you have the equivalent of what I have described for Rashba interface, locking of spin and momentum, and possible efficient conversion between charge and spin current, or between spin and charge currents. And so these experiments have been, there are already some experimental spin pumping that have shown that some spin-off decoupling can be introduced in graphene. These experiments done by Mendes and co-worker in Recife in Brazil. And as you can see, there is a spin-pumping experiment as those that they have described. And what appears also, one sees some broadening of the line. That means some of the spin accumulation due to the resonance are absorbed by the interface by graphene below, graphene between above here. And there is also some signal appearing. That means that there is a small rush by effect. But there is not a very strong enhancement. This is something. Finally, the conversion is 100 times smaller than with a topological insulator. So the objective, the challenge could be to, it's not surprising because YIG, the ferromagnetic insulator, YIG has not a strong hybridization with graphene. And so the introduction is only small of spin orbit graphene. And one important challenge is to find other systems to introduce a stronger spin-orbit coupling graphene. Gold is one of the ideas, because there are already these ARPES measurements that have shown that by ARPES one has seen the splitting of the direct cone into several direct cones. And one of the ideas, so one of the ideas, for example, another example which is promising, putting permaiol on graphene also induce some additional damping in permaloy that can be seen. The damping corresponds to the slope of this line. I don't explain exactly what are the experiments. One sees by adding permaloy with some protection of graphene by copper means that spin pumping onto permaloy can induce a can inject some spin into graphene. So these experiments are appealing. And if I want to end my talk by two other slides, another system that are really interesting is combining graphene with other two-dimensional materials with large spin-orbit coupling. So trying to, for this is the transition metal disalkogenide. These transition metal disalkogenide are two-dimensional systems, like this one, for example, is tungsten selenium 2. This is a three-layer but a two-dimensional conduction, is semiconductor with a poor conductivity. So he has a strong spin-orbit coupling, but a poor conductivity. So it's not at all the high conductivity of graphene. But what is can be expected is by combining one of these two-dimensional materials with large spin coupling and poor conductivity with graphene is creating at the interface a two-dimensional electron gas in graphene that has, at the same time, keeps the mobility of graphene and introduce with the introduction of large spin coupling and introduction of all these effects that I have already described. And there are already maybe one appealing results. This one is for TMD on graphene and is with tungsten selenium 2, S2. And you see the structure. The structure is the disalkogenide, the TMD, and graphene on the top. In some condition of voltage, of gate voltage, what they have seen is what is called the spin-all effect of two-dimensional electron gas. That is, they don't see the polarization that I have described and explained by the electron effect, but they have been apparently to see the creation of a spin current going transversally in one of these directions that I have already described. And so this is the experimental results. There is a charge current passing into the one of the channels of this structure. And there is this sort of structure. So the interpretation of this curve is that there is a spin-all effect that injecting a spin current in this direction, this spinal effect, and by injecting this spincron in the second track here, this spincron is transformed in a charged current that can be detected by this voltage here. And so you can see the variation of this voltage as a function of this distance. These results are not completely clear, but it seems that in this software structure, this is one of the first examples of introduction of spin orbit in graphene to obtain a typical effect of conversion similar to the spinal effect. So I suppose this is the last slide. Simply the last slide is simply this one, that this experimental result can be explained by theoretical calculations that show that at the interface with this TMD, the direct cone of graphene is split into two direct cones with this structure and a spin polarization, a locking between spin and momentum on the Fermi contour that can be obtained at different energies corresponding to this structure. So I suppose this is the last slides. Generally, I have a last slide with my coworker, a photo of my coworker, but for this very long course, this very long lecture, there were so many coworkers that can be included all in the same slides. So I have no slide of this type. So what I can say that during these four lectures, I tried to cover the spintronics from the beginning, the physical base of the spintronics, that is, and the discovery of the GMR, the simple application of the GMR. It was the first lecture, very simple. Then I proceeded to the classical spintronics, so spintronics that will be used with effects like TMR, STT, all the effects that will be used in the next generation of computer, that the computer that will appear in 2 or 3 years. We have seen that what is important potential of spintronic in this new generation of computer and more generally device for communication and computing technologies. And then at the end, I started on this new direction of spin orbit electronics, which is one of the most promising direction today. And I have not, or okay, it's not the end, because as you see, I say a few words on the skirmions, which is also inside the spin electronics. And so I hope that next year I could give also additional picture, several pictures on the skirmions, this new animals that are called skirmions, interesting animals. And also, next year, I will also begin to speak about what is called bio and spore computing. I have some slides, but it is too short. You know that there are strong difference between the computing in your brain and the computing in your computer. In your brain is purely, it's not digital at all, and also you see that your brain is what is the difference also is the brain is more massively parallel, and also the difference is that the transmission of the information is through synapses that not only transmit the information from neuron to neuron, but also keep some memory. So the synapse become more or less transmitted depending on the information. So that in your brain, what does not exist in the computer, that the circuitry evolves continuously. And so one knows that if it was possible to do the same, the computer can be much more efficient. So there is a new tendency in the development of the technology of the computer that to try to imagine new components that can play the role of the synapse or the role of the neurons with And will be completely different one from the transistors that we have today in our components. And so there is an important development that we begin in our laboratory, and so this will be also the second part of my lecture next year, if I come back. I suppose I will come back. Okay, thank you for your attention. Thank you. I like it.
And I hope you will come back for another next year.
Yeah, I will come back, yeah.
And so thank you very much. It's very important for us, your visits and all the enthusiasm that you're creating in young people that want to work now in electronics. So thank you very much for coming.
Okay. I've been very happy, okay, to be with you several days. And to have this collaboration, all these discussions that I had during this week.
Sí, pues hay que fomentar más colaboración y que los grupos, Laura y Edna, contamos con ustedes para que se haga un proyecto grande, importante y que involucre a mucha gente.
But also, if you have some scientific question about my talk today, maybe we have some time for these questions. Are there questions? No questions this time? Generally, there was a lot of questions. But there are impressed by you with that shy today.
I will leave.
Okay. A question here? Yeah. You have a question? Yeah. Microphone.
I have a question here. Well, yeah. Okay. So, well, it's a technical question. Well, it's time to do that. Okay. Well, this is the best conversion of the spin hole angle that you can get in graphene by proximity. Yeah. Or is there any other material that can increase this hole angle?
Increase some. Okay, I will say the proximity with gold is an example by RPS that this splitting of the cones exists with gold. So there are RPS measurements. With YIG, the effect was relatively small. So TMD. There is a lot of material of this type, transition metal dichalcogenide. So there are certainly other materials that I don't know very well. I received yesterday a paper from a group in Singapore, apparently with another type of material, but I don't remember exactly what it is. What I know for the moment is mainly this family of TMD.
Oh, yes, this is a question about the spin-seebeck effect. The spin-seebeck effect is produced by spin orbit interaction or by another mechanism.
The spin-seebeck effect is related to the spin orbit effect. Suppose, for example, that is the experiment I described, there was a ferromagnetic material from which one injects a spin current into platinum, and the spin current is transformed in charge current. In the spin-seebeck effect, you have a magnetic material, insulating in general, and with a thermal gradient, a flow of heat. But a flow of heat in a ferromagnetic material is goes with a flow of spin, because heat is magnets, is spins, and so, and by sending a flow, the thermal flow, and the resulting spin currents associated with the platinum before, below, a charge current and a voltage. This is a pin-seebeck effect, exactly como the effect I have described, spin pumping on platinum, except that now the spin is generated by some interesting effect to transform some thermal flow into electrical power. Okay, and it takes with the spin-seebeck effect means that below you have a material like, but with a two-dimensional electron gas, I know that it will be much more efficient than simply with platinum. Or by the Nernst effect of topological insulator. Nernst effect is another type of effect. Nernst effect will be also a little more efficient.
In the case of the next big thing, I mean the bio-inspired electronics, you know.
Bio?
Bio-inspired electronics coming for the future. Do you know if there is any linkage between the spin orbit electronics you said with the new synaptics electronics?
Yeah, you say if this bio-inspired electronics can be done with spintronics, yeah, we're working in this direction, not only with spintronics, but also with ferroelectric materials. The first synapse that we have created, we have two publications in Nature Materials, are based on the harnessing ferroelectric materials. But we have also some projects with spintronic materials of synapse. It's easier, okay. Synapse is relatively easier. Neuron is a little more complex.
It's going the same way in this bio-inspired new electronics inspired from the brain. As I think the brain, it's kind of a disordered system. I think synapses and all these things, they follow paths, aleatory paths, I don't know. And okay, spintronics,
but the memory, really,
really ordered systems.
The memory, what we have learned is some order in this path.
Yeah, that's great. Okay.
So it's not a question.
I see a kind of a jump between these high-ordered systems in spintronics to be used as synapses. I can't understand.
Okay. So you have to have the main idea is to have the architecture of with this complex architecture you are referring to, but the elements in this architecture, you must have synapse and neurons, and so the idea is simply to create elements that can mimic the operation of the synapse and the neuron, and so the architecture will be disorder. Will not the very ordered architecture of the computer today. There will be this sort of complex circuitry. Okay. But complex circuitry with spintronics or electronic components, synapse, equivalent to the synapse and the neurons. Because each element is simple. A neuron is a simple element alone. Okay. A synapse is something simple, relatively simple. Okay. So what is complex is the organization of these things. But First, we have to fabricate the single element, the synapse and the neuron, and then the organization is something else that people computing are thinking about. Okay. Thank you.